Well, hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar. Oh my gosh, I am so excited about my guest today, Kayla Hutchens. and I'll tell you why in a little bit, but I'm just thrilled she's here and we've been preparing for this for quite a while. So we are super, super excited. But I'm also very excited to celebrate Administrative Professionals Week with you. So happy Administrative Professionals Week. Woohoo! I hope you are having an awesome week. And gosh, I can't believe it's here already. And I also hope you've been enjoying our 8 days of celebration. I don't know if you're aware of what we've been doing. We've been having a blast. With our Magic Moments contest and our gratitude photo contest. And of course, we've got our webinar today. Tomorrow, we've got a Q&A and a lot of other things. So we'll tell you more about that later. I don't want to take up a lot of time because I know that we have a lot of information to share with you, or at least Kayla does, not so much me. So as far as our logistics, 40 to 45 minutes are the educational part of our webinar. You can submit your questions at any time throughout the webinar. And then after we're done with the educational part, we will go to Q&A. And I think, Kayla, we're going to have a lot of questions, I bet, for you today, which is wonderful news. Also, you'll receive a replay link. So that's great, because you will not be able to capture everything Kayla is going to share, but we also have a surprise for you. You are going to receive Kayla's 16-page guide in terms of how to be a champion for your own professional training as well as that of others in your organization. So yes, she put together this entire guide in detail. And you're going to receive that when we send, let me see, I think when we send you your email with your certificate. So you don't have to worry about taking a lot of notes today. The other exciting announcement we have today, I'm really happy about this. We came out with a new downloadable ebook. Woohoo! We haven't had an ebook out for been a little while. I'll just say that. And the topic. Here's the title, Strategic Thinking for Assistants. I know this is a necessary skill, and we've been teaching having a lot of sessions and talk about strategic thinking. And it ties in beautifully with what Kayla is going to talk about today, because she definitely had to strategically think about how she would champion for her professional development and that of others in her organization. So what
we're going to do, excuse me one second. I apologize. We're getting some squelching and feedback. Kayla, can you turn your volume down a little bit?
How's that?
Okay, Joan, go ahead and let me
see if it's my volume too. Okay.
Perfect.
And so anyways, we are going to give away 5 ebooks during our webinar today. So some of you will win that. And then also we will make it available for purchase today at a special launch price of $12.95. So I just wanted you to know that. All right, let me tell you the story of Kayla and I, and also why this all fits together so beautifully. Our theme this year is You Are Awesome. And we kicked off our theme last week with Sunny Noonan, who, if you saw her, she was amazing. And Sunny talked a lot about advocating for yourself in many different ways. And this is one way that Kayla certainly advocated for herself in honing in on professional development. So the short story of how I remember meeting Kayla, well, first of all, it was really, I met her leader, her phenomenal leader, James Bristow, five or six years ago. James and I belong to a CEO group here in the Las Vegas Valley. And he and I immediately hit it off. I do want to tell you that James is 30 years younger than me. So, you know, that's kind of interesting in itself, how we connected and how we've been best friends over all these years, not only business colleagues, and we actually authored this book together last year. And so James, what I loved about James and still love to this day, is he truly values the strategic partnership and having a strategic partnership with his assistant. And he was fully supportive of education and professional development for his assistant and some staff members. So when I met James, Kayla, you were his assistant at that time, you came on later, but the assistant I had met, James had sent that person to some of our classes, our world-class course and so forth. And then Kayla came on, and how I got to know Kayla, so she did attend our world-class assistant certification and designation course in 2021. And I am going to read her bio in just a moment, so I won't go into everything. But I think what really stood out for me, Kayla, was the first, I think this was the very first time that when you showed up in my office and we talked about the course that I had newly launched, the Executive Support Series. That was a complete online course with 48 videos. And you had gone through that whole course, and I'm pretty sure you were the first one to receive the designation for that course. That was the CESP designation. And I asked you, I believe, to come in because I wanted to get your feedback about the course because you were the first one, and it was so exciting. And ever since then, we've been connected. She has attended our conferences several times. And of course, we work very closely because of the book project and so forth. So let me read you the bio on Kayla. And I have to vouch for her just to show you how professional and organized this woman is. She's always impressive. She likes to give me options. And so she gave me a long bio in case I wanted to use that. She gave me a condensed bio in case I needed that, and a short bio. So Kayla's always demonstrates being very proactive. I picked the condensed bio because it's pretty close to the short one. So Kayla has 20 years of experience as an administrative professional and is currently an executive assistant for James Bristow, managing partner at Universal Engineering Sciences. She joined the UES family of companies in July of 2020. Kayla's passionate about supporting her executive in the organization, pursuing professional development opportunities, and upholding a commitment to excellence. Definitely. She has fostered a high-functioning strategic partnership with James, adding exponential value to UES. Kayla's commitment to excellence in her administrative professional roles led her to earn 3 professional designations in 18 months. This woman does not stop, and that's in addition to her full-time job, earning the first 2 in just 8 months. As a lifelong learner, where am I? Kayla's passion for her professional development has grown into mentoring other admins and championing, I love that word, training opportunities for other administrative professionals in the organization she has worked in. In 2022, Kayla was awarded the Joan Burge Innovation Award. Yes, she was, at our annual conference here in Las Vegas. This award recognized Kayla for her work in successfully being the champion of professional development training for other administrative professionals in her organization. In her free time, do you have free time, woman? Her free time, she loves being creative. Oh, definitely. Through photography, creative writing, woodburning, creating tumblers, crafting various projects, and baking cookies and bringing them to the Office Dynamics team. All right, Kayla, I am going to turn it over to you. And I believe we're going to start out, we talked about starting out why learning is so important to you. And welcome, by the way.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here. Learning has always been important to me because I've always wanted to feel like I was contributing and adding value. And so learning has helped me build my confidence to do that. And I've always been my parents' why child. Like I've always wanted to know all the things.
So ever since you were, it started when you were young, that hunger and thirst, and then did that grow and evolve as you went into the workplace?
Yes. So unfortunately for me, I was a little late to the admin training world. And so early in my career, I wanted to add value. And so I would learn anything I could learn. I learned how to do HTML coding, SQL writing, HR, payroll, union reports, anything I could learn to add value and become a bigger asset for my company.
And are you pretty much self-taught through that? I mean, what do I mean by that? You are the one seeking out the tools to help you learn and grow.
Yeah, I would go to my leaders and say, you know, I'm not busy enough. What else can I learn to really get into creating value for the company? The SQL writing and HTML coding, I had team members who said, okay, you'll see what you can figure out on your own. Mm-hmm. And then we'll check you. And in 2 days or 3 days, I had learned SQL writing. I had unioned 3 data systems together, and I created code that was like 3 11 by 17 pages long and impressed them. So always trying to learn something.
You never stop. What I think what's interesting, and I know we're going to get to the whole process in a moment. I think it's good to lay the foundation. I think what's interesting too, with as much as you learn, and all these achievements with your designations and so forth, you still have that hunger and thirst. I feel that's where you and I do connect, even though our ages are, there's quite a difference there. But like you, I've always been a lifelong student, you know, ever since I went to school, but especially as I started working right out of high school. And I've just always had that hunger to learn and grow and just, yeah, and it doesn't stop even at this stage of my life. Even though I've learned a lot, there's so much more to learn, right?
Yeah.
And I think that's how you feel. So we're going to we're going to get into your process. And so for this, for everyone else, again, you're going to have this in detail, but Kayla's going to walk you through it. And then this way you may have some questions where you really want to have her delve into it a little bit more. So Kayla, I know you had a very methodical process, very detailed, and you're going to walk our attendees through the different facets of your guide, correct? And are you ready? And I want everyone to know too, this right here is another big growth spurt for Kayla. I keep prodding her. And after she received the Innovation Award last year and I saw what she did, I told her kind of jokingly, but seriously, you need to do a webinar now. And she was like, yeah, maybe we'll see. And I think it took a few months, and then finally I get an email. I think I want to try the webinar. So let's all give Kayla a hand too for stepping up to that next big challenge. All right, I'll turn it over to you.
Okay. So when I started to look into training opportunities for myself a couple years ago, I did what I thought was you're supposed to do. This is what I want to do. Took it to my manager, said, this is what I want to do. And I didn't have a ton of success doing it that way. And it wasn't until I realized that professional development and investing in that, no matter what the role is a business decision. And you really need to treat it that way. And you need to approach it that way. And so I worked on building my executive presence and my executive language. I needed to learn what my company's KPIs are. And I've got a little slide for you guys. KPIs are key performance indicators. And to know which KPIs your organization is using is key. Because when you look into training, you want to find training that'll impact those KPIs positively. Examples are employee retention, operating margin, billable utilization, profit margin, revenue growth. If you don't know what those are, look into them. If your organization is using a different KPI and you don't know what it is, look into it so that you can find training that'll positively impact these. The other thing I had to learn was the ROI, the return on investment. When you're looking for training, you need to make sure that the return on investment is going to be positive for the organization because it is a business decision. If you're new to training or haven't done training before, you'll have to speak to the anticipated ROI, which is what you expect the return, the return on investment to be. And whenever possible, put a dollar value to it. Not always possible, depending on the topic, but you can usually find a couple things if you're doing like the conference. There's so many different speakers and opportunities to learn that you can usually find something you can put a dollar value on. For example, the very first conference I ever went to, I learned a time-saving trick in Excel that saved me 5 hours every month for a report that I had to do every week. I taught that to nine other staff, so admins and project managers and our head of IT. When I took the 5 hours by 12 months by nine staff and averaged out our salaries, it was return on investment of $18,900, so almost $19,000 for the cost or price of the conference I went to. And that was just one thing I learned. I brought back other stuff. I came back and I created monthly lunch and learns where we were teaching with admins, we're teaching each other our skills and tips and tricks. So when you're getting ready to present or ask for training, you need to make sure that you're you know what your anticipated ROI is and what KPI or KPIs you will be addressing.
And Kayla, I want to, before you move on, because I think the ROI part is really important, and that is so hard. I mean, you were able to capture that one with the Excel training, correct? I know the ROIs are hard sometimes when you're learning the intangibles. Mm-hmm. At Office Dynamics, that's what we teach. You know, we've been teaching for 32 years, the intrapersonal skills. So that's not as always easy to measure unless it's very specific, like I said, like that, or you're increasing your keyboarding skill or something that's measurable. So, but you have to figure that out, right?
Yeah. So like I mentioned, you can't always put a dollar sign to it. But like the KPI of employee retention, those intangible skills relate to that, because when an employee feels valued, they're being invested in, they're more likely to stay with the company, which ultimately saves the company the cost of having to search for a new employee, train that employee, and then have turnover again. It's a positive KPI. Also learning the communication styles and being able to communicate more effectively. Well, now you're getting work done faster because you're communicating more effectively. It's a positive KPI you can't put a dollar sign on, but it's an anticipated ROI that you can speak to.
Okay, that's really good. That's a great explanation. And I like tying back to the retention piece. That was really good. And then I was also thinking, because I know James and I certainly talked about that, we talked about a lot in the book, as far as why you need an EA, is the percentage of time. I think what someone could present, and I don't know if you've done this too in some of those presentations and selling your training, is by learning these particular skills, right, where you're listing them, the communication skills, like you said, and so forth, but also in supporting your leader and maybe how you learn how to be that strategic thinker, partner, and take things off their plate. You could probably say, okay, by me learning how to do this, I'm now going to save my executive probably 20% of, or increases productivity by 20% what does that equate to? So maybe, did you ever talk about just that increase in productivity by what you learn?
Yeah, so for
that way?
Yeah. When I presented the first year for trying to get the admins in the Western division of my current organization, I talked about how they would learn skill sets to be able to take things off of their manager's plate, saving them an hour a day or 4 hours a week or whatever that particular project was for that particular manager. Mm-hmm. And if they had 5 more hours a week, what more could they do?
Okay, great. So then we're gonna, I know hurdle. Oh, did we talk about investment versus cost? And we have that, that's next, right?
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
Right, so the other executive language that I make sure that I use when I'm presenting for training is I use the word investment or investment amount. I never call it a cost because cost doesn't have a return on investment. And so when you're talking about professional training and you go, I want to go to this conference, I'll learn X, Y, and Z. These are the KPIs that will be positively impacted. This is the anticipated ROI. And your executive goes, well, what's it going to cost? You go, well, the investment amount is, and just make sure that you're using that word investment, because what that does is it highlights that it is a business decision that'll have a positive impact. And it's not just a burden of a cost.
Yeah, that's very, very smart. And I starred that one because I know that was something I learned when I first started Office Dynamics. I learned, don't say, when a potential client calls, don't say cost, say investment. And you're right, it is an investment an organization makes in developing you, and they do expect to get a return on that, right?
Yes.
So you did come across some hurdles, of course, over the years.
I did, yes. So some of the common hurdles throughout my career that I found when wanting to get professional development training was I would identify training and it wasn't in that year's budget because the admin profession historically has been overlooked. And that was one of the other hurdles is most of the executives that I worked with the exception of James, is they don't know that quality admin training is available. I didn't know for 15 years of my career. So they don't know what they don't know. Mm-hmm. And so that's a hurdle. And then for any time you're presenting professional development training opportunities to an executive who's never invested in it before and hasn't seen the return on investment, that's going to be a hurdle that you have to cross too. And that one is easiest to negate if you self-invest and they see the return on investment that way. And you don't have to do a training that several thousand dollars. You can do a tech webinar or something along that lines, and then show them that you're able to apply what you learn. This is the return on investment from that, and they'll be more apt in the future mm-hmm. to put it in the budget or to approve training.
And so you touched on a lot of good points. I want to circle back with you just briefly is the budget. That's a huge one. I've heard that for so many years, right? It's not in the budget. There's also a time you have to be a little more assertive. I mean, I know I did it as a secretary. And when I was a secretary and wanted training, it was like completely unheard of, but it's being creative with that. And I did discover that depending on my executive, if I could really sell them on that course I wanted to go to, AMA had it, American Management Association. They were the only ones who had some great admin training then. But they can get it. They could also get creative with their budget. I think part of it is too, you have to be persuasive because I get it as a boss, I have a budget, we have budgets, I get it. I also feel sometimes though that assistant or employee isn't really showing how badly they want that training and what that value is. And if you, and Kayla, you know, you took this a world-class assistant and you learned persuasion skills, right? That was a part of it, being persuasive. And you did it when you had to go to really high level management to get at all the admins or several of your admins from the company to come to our conference. So I think, could you speak to that for a moment about, I don't know if it was in other parts of what you're going to talk. I know you're going to talk about presenting and so forth, but I think that's a really important piece. You have to be sold on it yourself, right?
Yeah.
And believe in that you deserve that. And
yeah, so with the budget, yes, it's a lot of times it's not in the budget and you'll get that response. But when you present it as a business case rather than just training that you want to improve, and you have that executive level presentation and the executive presence and the executive language, and you present it as this is a business opportunity to invest in really your biggest assets are your employees. You can't do your work without, you know, the staff. And a lot of times there is wiggle room in the budget. You just have to get creative. And when I presented that first year, it wasn't in the budget for most of the offices for training their admins. They'd never participated in admin training before. But every single one of the offices sent their office manager or an executive assistant. And it's because I presented it as a sound business decision with a potential really high return on investment. And I was very passionate about it when I was presenting.
Yeah, it's excellent what you did. So the hurdles, let's see, did we cover all the hurdles? They don't know what they don't know. I mean, I do want to speak to that one because this even goes way back, but it's the same today. You know, when they hear some leaders or managers or organizations, they think, oh, this is just some cute little training program, you know, that you're going to go to and have fun for the day. And, you know, unless they see it's a tech course, that's that they could clearly see. But it's when the soft skills, which we teach again, and they don't realize the type of training that's out there today, which is why I started Office Dynamics. I didn't want people to think it was, and that's all I got actually as an assistant. These one day pump you up, and they could have given that workshop to anybody. It was not admin career focused. And that's why I started my company, so there would be robust training. And so part of your pitch, you know, also, like you said, is letting them know that there is quality training. This isn't just something you're doing for fun or because you want to get away from your work for a while, correct?
Yeah. And then, you know, tying it into whatever is the company's value and mission, their KPIs, or anything that's timely to the organization. Like after COVID, all sorts of organizations were struggling with keeping positive company culture virtually. Oh, you find a training session that helps cover that. And they're like, oh, well, yeah, that makes sense. That is a good opportunity to invest in. We're struggling there right now. So when you can tie your training into things that are current and timely for your organization, adds value to them as well as you, you're going to have better results.
Excellent. That is an excellent point. I love it. All right. So what's the next step we have?
So once you know what hurdles you're going to have to face, and you remember that you're going to have to present it as a business case and use executive speak, you need to research. There is so much out there in the admin professional development training world that you need to research all the different types of training that's out there, and so that you can identify one that adds value to you and to your organization. There are webinars such as this one that are free if you sign up with the different companies and speakers and all the people that are out there. There are paid webinars, and that's an affordable way to self-invest if you really need to self-invest before you can get your manager or your executive to come on board. And those range anywhere from $50 to $200 for an hour short snippet of a skill that you can immediately start applying to your daily work. There are also the designation courses, which is more than just a piece of paper or letters after your name. It shows a commitment to mastering skills in your field and wanting to stay on top of your game, which is great. And then there's also conferences and summits where you get exposed to all sorts of training opportunities, different topics. It gives you a chance to network, which is always great. There's all these, because of COVID, there's all these online summits that you can do where it's 2 or 3 days of intense back-to-back courses, but you come away from those and you take them back and do a debrief for your executive, or you start applying what you learn and they start seeing that return on investment. You're more efficient, you're taking on more work, you're passionate, like you're re-engaged in what you do. Those are all positive ROIs.
Yeah. And the great part for you, as I view it, you've taken advantage of all these different opportunities. The webinars, our conferences you've come to, you've again taken your certification and designation courses. So it's great because you have a real feel for what's out there. And then I think that leads us to, is this the one about how do you identify what you need?
Yeah, we kind of touched base on it already.
A little bit, yes.
Don't spend too much time here, but once you identify the opportunity, so like in my case, it was the Office Dynamic Conference here in Las Vegas that I identified because the topics were timely to current concerns in my organization. I was aiming to not only attend myself, but I wanted every one of our Western region offices that had an office manager to participate and send their office manager. And so location-wise, it made sense. It made sense on the values and mission of our company. And then it also was a great way to build the culture and show support of their admins, because all of our offices, they're phenomenal and they love their admins and they're very respectful of them and constantly saying thank you. But it was a really good way to really show that and to help grow them so that they could be even more phenomenal than they already were.
And while we're on that really quick, I noticed it just popped up a question. Somebody, if we could go back to what is a KPI?
Key performance indicator, and it is a metric to measure performance in different areas within the business.
Okay, thank you. All right, before we go to the next step, which I think is the ask, right?
Gathering all the data.
The data. Okay, so I'm going to, before we do that, let's give away two of our new downloadable ebooks, Strategic Thinking for Assistants. So Malia, I don't know if you're still hanging out with us, but could you let us know who our two winners are?
Absolutely. We have our Heather.
Brand new ebook.
Yes, brand new ebook. Heather Leverage and April Chavez.
Yay. Congratulations. I hope you enjoy it. All right. Now Kayla's really going to dig in.
Okay, so once you've identified the opportunity that you want to request either for yourself or for your team, you need to gather all of your data so you can put a presentation together. The where, what, when, why, the investment amount. And then you also need to, I like to get the agenda and the brochure. You don't need to create the wheel. A lot of times these summits or conferences or training have great marketing material. Use it, take it. They know best on how to sell the training. You're interested in it because of what you read. So you can use that information and not have to start from scratch. When I did my presentation, I went to the conference website took information about the history and reputation of the of Office Dynamics. I also took some of their marketing material and used why you should send your admin in person, and then added some that were a little more personal to my organization, but I didn't have to do it all from scratch. I didn't have to reinvent the wheel. And that was my first two slides, because I presented to a group of executives, and so I did a 4-page PowerPoint.
That was a big undertaking as far as who you were going to present to, and then gathering all the information for that. So what's next?
So once you have all your information, you have to think about your audience. Are you presenting to just your executive, or are you presenting to a group? And when you're presenting to either your executive or your group, you need to take their communication style into consideration. Are they 50,000 foot view bullet points? Are they want all the details? Are they want the story? And just make sure that you target your presentation to the communication style of the individual that you're presenting to, or if you're presenting to a group, cater your presentation to all communication styles. For mine, I was presenting to multiple communication styles. And so I had my four-page PowerPoint for my bullet executives. I had my details, which was the agenda, the brochure, for my detail executives that I was going to email out immediately following my presentation. And then when I was presenting, I covered the story. I let my passion go through. I spoke to my own personal experiences, and I was able to hit all the communication styles in order to have the most impact. And then I followed up about 2 or 3 days later with anybody I hadn't heard back from. And it was my story people that they just wanted more story. And I shared more story, and then they wound up participating as well.
Yeah, that's really cool. And I know the styles, of course, extremely important, because we talk about that a lot at Office Dynamics. We've been teaching about communication style for 32 years, and we have it in a lot of our courses. And also knowing James and knowing me, we're the red, really quick bullet point, give it to us, be decisive, what do you want? You know, all of that, right? And then also, though, my backup style is my detail analysis style. So if you were coming to me, right, I'd want it short, to the point, tell me what it is, and so forth. And then because of my backup style, I probably study it for a few days just in my quiet time to be able to analyze that. So I also like that idea, one, tapping in directly to that style. And then also, I like that you are prepared for all those styles, because for some people, they may have the dominant style, but their backup style may require something else. So you covered all your bases, basically, whether you would have used that or not. And I think that's smart. Then you're ready, correct?
Yeah.
And then were there other things that you took into consideration with you got the pictures, anything else as far as considering the audience?
Being aware of the hurdles, like I said, one of the hurdles is they've never previously invested. They didn't know that this kind of training existed. And so I had to be prepared to speak to that. I knew it wasn't in their budgets because they hadn't done it before. And so I really had to be able to sell this as a positive business investment, and that this was a great opportunity, and the benefits that they would see if they could work it into their budgets.
Okay, great. So let's go on. The next is the actual presenting, correct? And I do have a quick question. When you did present, I don't remember, was that a virtual presentation you had done, correct?
Yeah, so for me, I first went to my executive, who super supportive of training. And so it wasn't a hard sell for me to go up to James and go, hey, I want to go to Office Dynamics conference this year. These are the topics. And he's like, cool, do it. Okay. I also want to get our other Western region offices to participate. And I would like time in the upcoming leadership meeting to present. And he goes, okay. He goes, what do you need from me? I said, just after I present, just share that you're supportive of admin training. That's it. This is my initiative. It doesn't require his executive capital. I just needed to have the platform and the opportunity to present.
And how did you get that, by the way? I don't remember. How did you get that opportunity? Did he help facilitate that meeting to get you to coordinate it, in other words? I mean, to help you get into that meeting.
So I was already a part of those meetings since he was running the Western Division. I was there 8 minutes, but it was adding me to the agenda and giving me that 10-minute window during that monthly meeting. Okay. And you know, just watching the time to make sure that I had the time to present and to answer questions. And
all right. Very good. We're doing good on time. We're at 10:41. So you're going to go into the next step of the presenting. And what about, let's see, are we on number 8, I think?
Yes. You presented and you're getting pushback. It's going to happen. You're not going to be successful every time. And one of the two biggest things to keep in mind when your executive's going, no, or I'm not sure, is don't take it personal. If you take it personal, you're going to get discouraged and you're only hurting yourself. The other thing is be willing to self-invest. It shows to your executive that this is important. It also gives you an opportunity to have an actual ROI to speak to next time. And then they see the difference in you. They see it as a positive investment. And that's really important. Even with as much support as I get from James on my own professional development, I still self-invest in myself every year. In addition to the professional development I get through my company. And it's really important to be willing to have skin in the game and show that you're willing to invest in this yourself. If you're not willing to invest in it yourself, why is it a wise business decision for your organization?
Wow. That was well said. All right. And then is there the call to action? You're going to
have
a little call to action for everyone.
I'm going to share.
And after that, we'll go to some questions.
Yes. So my call to action is I would love for you guys to connect with me on LinkedIn and share one thing that you'll take from today and pass on to a colleague that wasn't able to attend. I want to hear how you're going to take this information and advocate for yourself. I would love to continue these conversations with you as I feel that they are very important.
Yeah, they are. So take advantage of that and connect with Miss Kayla for sure. All right, let's do a few questions and then we'll do some giveaways again. But I want, what questions do we have, Malia?
Hello, we have lots of questions. Real quick, Kayla, can you show the KPI one more time?
Yeah.
Somebody was asking about that one. And then Terry would like to know, what do you recommend for those of us with managers who do not support professional development?
So that's where the self-investment comes in. Self-invest in yourself. And if they're still not willing to have an open discussion and be open to training, that's when you have to make a decision, because some executives are never going to be supportive. And is that a company or an executive that you want to continue to work for? And it's a hard decision. I've had to make those decisions myself. But self-invest. be able to go to them and go, look, I've self-invested. This is the return on investment you're getting. I'd really like you to support me moving forward.
And to add to that, because 32 years ago, I heard one of the best things I ever heard. It was just when I was starting, you know, Office Dynamics. But, and I did invest in myself and when I was a secretary as well as support. But it was Brian Tracy who said, the best thing you can ever invest in is yourself. Investing time, development, education, he said, because no one can ever take it away from you. When you invest in you, you're going to take it with you the rest of your life. No matter where you go, no matter what you do, you are building yourself so you have leverage for your future. And I thought that was the greatest thing I had ever heard. And he's absolutely right. You have you. Bottom line, other people may not be around you. Your leaders may come and go. Your colleagues may come and go. The 100% reliable person in your life is you. So why wouldn't you invest in you? Because that's an investment in your future, and you're a surefire stock to invest in. You can't depend on the others. So that was very valuable, you know, that I heard. And we see a lot of assistants who do invest in themselves. You know, Paula Thibodeau is another one. Our great friend in Canada, she invests in all her classes herself, her certifications, her designations. She's gotten some phenomenal positions. So anyways, what's the next question, Malia?
Claudia would like to know if you can share some of your self-investments, Kayla.
Yeah. So I'm currently registered for Office Dynamics Enlighten in June, and then I also just signed up for the Power Skills that starts in September for this year. So I've invested in both of those. I invested in Enlighten last year. I just signed up for a webinar. It was like $12 that's in May. And then I'm currently doing executive coaching that was more than I could afford on my own. And so I self-invested and got my organization to help invest in that.
Okay, good. Yeah, the power skills. So they're asking about the power skills. So that is one of our courses, a new course that came out last year. And Julie Reed is one of our elite trainers. And that's her baby. I had her create the entire course. It's 7 significant power skills. And there's 7 2-hour sessions. So we just announced the dates on our website. And Julie's an amazing facilitator. So, all right, next question.
Okay. Ari would like to know, do you have any tips or tricks when you know that there's a budget, but they keep that number a secret?
Be passionate and present it as a business case. Tell them why it's a good business investment. Align it to the KPIs that they're currently tracking. Make sure that you know what the anticipated return on investment is. Like Joan mentioned earlier, there's usually a way to get creative with the budget, and you don't have to know what the budget is. And if they go, well, this really isn't in the budget, then negotiate. Be like, well, would you pay, like if it's for a conference, if I pay for the travel, will you invest in the conference itself? There's a way to kind of meet them halfway to show that you're willing to invest in it, which will help incline them to as well.
Great.
Malia, while you're doing that, really quick, I got so involved in Kayla and what she's saying, and I did want to get to questions. Really quick though, I noticed too something you wanted to quickly discuss or we wanted to talk about were the payoffs. And I apologize for missing that bullet point. So if we could do that for a moment and then we'll go back to questions, but I think the payoff is really important for our attendees to hear and how it helped you.
Yeah, so the payoffs I've gotten from doing my training is one, a sense of pride. Two, it's built my confidence. And another thing I'm really passionate about besides professional development is finding and using your voice as an admin. We have such a positive impact on our organizations, and yet we don't speak up. And when we speak up, we add it to the positive impact. And learning helped build my confidence enough that I found my voice and I now use it. I will speak up in meetings. I will add the administrative perspective on a topic because I'm the only one in the room that has it. And I've been able to positively impact things. I'll tell you a quick story and it'll show you the power of using your voice. I used to work for a global company. The CEO, CFO, and COO were in town for board meetings and we all went out for drinks afterwards. And the CEO asked me and another admin what could be done better. And I'd only been there for a year. I was a little hesitant to speak freely, but he goes, no, really, because I want to know, because we're not going to improve as an organization if we don't hear from it. And the program that we were using to track projects and we did all our fiscal budgeting out of, the data that was going in was not good. The people entering when the projects were going to end were not putting in the right dates. They were putting when the next stage was going to start. And so our projections for the whole year had been completely skewed, either positively or negatively. And I told him this, and I said, we need to retrain our staff or we need to find a different system. It's our financial projections are never going to be accurate if we don't do something. 18 months later, they rolled out a new program.
Wow. Wow. That's amazing. That's a great story. Thank you for sharing that. All right. Was there anything else you wanted to add with that?
Yeah. Again, with finding my voice, it allowed me to become a servant leader by helping the other admins in my organization and leading by example and wanting to add value to others. And so now I mentor some of the other admins in my organization.
Yeah, that's awesome. All right, Malia, let's do another question and then I think, let's see where we are. What's the next question?
Okay, so Francois is asking, how important are those letters behind your name? He's asking because he doesn't have any. He says, as I became an administrative professional with my education from abroad, it was not recognized and therefore he's almost fully self-taught. And then to piggyback on that, Kim is asking who you got your designations through.
So the designations, after your name, what that does is it shows a commitment to mastering the skills and knowledge of your field. It's a not really a status symbol, but when you go to look for another job, it shows that you're as good as your resume says you are. You've done the education, you've done the training, you're committed to being the top of your field, which is great. I've got my designation, two of them I got from Office Dynamics, the CWCA and the CESP, and then the ACEA, I forget the actual organization, but it was through executive support. It's a program that they run.
Mm-hmm. And I want to say really quick too, with the designation with the one that Kayla achieved with our world-class assistant. So something that's a little different. There's designation courses where you study a lot of online materials and videos like Kayla did with one of our courses. It was all video and online. And then you take a quiz, have to pass the test. That's a lot of the typical out there. But with our STAR course and our world class, That's a curriculum-based designation, meaning no one can achieve that unless they go to the curriculum, because it isn't so much about studying and passing a test. It's demonstrating what you learn in the classroom. And to me, that's powerful. I did get my certified secretarial designation when I was a secretary. And I know I studied and studied six different books, hundreds of pages, just to pass the test. But a lot of it I didn't even use after that was over. So that's the other point I want to bring out. Knowing what designations are out there, you want to make sure that they're teaching you skills that you're using at work in your day to day. And again, like Kayla, she's proven herself through the classes that she's creative, that she understands how to tactfully give feedback, because they have to role play it in my class. So that's a really important piece. They have our participants demonstrate that they've grasped what we're teaching and they're doing it. And it's through observation that the facilitators have to say, I've observed this. I've observed you being a team player. I've observed you being creative, collaborative, lead, taking a lead in the breakout sessions. So that's a huge difference that I had to talk about that. And Kayla, you've experienced both the online and the having to be experiential with it.
Yep.
All right. So let's see. What are we going to do? Is there one more pressing question? Because I hate to shortchange them. Let's do that. And then we're going to have some giveaways of the ebook.
Okay. This one's a little interesting. Marianne would like to know, did you find that there's a certain time of year that's best to approach management?
So
that's a good question.
It is. Doing it before they do the next year's budget is always a good idea, especially if the training is going to take place in the following fiscal year, because then they can work it into the budget they're creating for the year. So that's always a really good time. Last year, I presented in March. Towards the end of March, and hinted at Admin Day. What a great way to show appreciation by investing in your admins. So there's different times, and then you also have to be very cognizant of what's going on in your organization. If they just did mass layoffs, probably not the best time to request training.
Yeah, for sure. And yeah, if they're in anything tense, if it's maybe you're a seasonal business and there's certain times a year that you're industry are busier than others, so you want to pick that time that's most opportune for you. All right, let's do Kayla. We'll do a wrap up. But first of all, I want to give away some more of the ebooks, our new downloadable ebook. As you could see, Kayla certainly is a strategic thinker. So now we have a downloadable ebook on that. And for today only, we have our launch price of $12.95 if you do want to purchase a copy. But we have, let's pick three winners for Strategic Thinking for Assistants.
All right. We have Babby Williams, Carly Ankning, and Ronak Joshi.
Yay, congratulations. So I want to remind everyone too, this week, some of the other events we have going on tomorrow. What do we have? A Q&A with me, actually, and that's where you can ask me any question you want. Well, pretty much any question you want, and that's going to be on Zoom. We're doing that through Zoom. It's not a webinar like this. So if you want to join me tomorrow, that's the way I want to celebrate you, is that you ask me whatever you'd like and whatever help you need. So we're going to do that. I'm excited. What is it? Thursday, we're having a virtual gratitude circle via Zoom. So if you want to join us for that as well. And then the end of the week, I'm going to do a Facebook Live, which I haven't done in a really long time, to kind of wrap up everything that we have talked about over the past 8 days. Enlighten is June 15 and 16. That's our mid-year two-day live virtual event, and we have amazing speakers for that. And then we are going to start another world-class assistant. I just graduated a class, last week, and Julie is going to teach the next round, Julie Reed, and that starts in July. So Kayla, how did it go? How do you feel now that you tackled this next big thing of presenting on camera?
I think it's great. Like I'm so appreciative of the opportunity to be able to share this with so many more people that I would have been able to do on my own. Mm-hmm. So thank you. And I do have one final thought for this.
Yes.
The attendees. Back to that slide, because somebody in the chat asked me to share this again.
Okay, good.
Just my personal philosophy, when you learn something new, you add value to yourself. And when you find and use your voice, sharing what you've learned, you start adding value to others.
Oh, excellent. Excellent. Thank you, Kayla. Great job. I'm so excited. We're going to figure out your next stretch assignment. No, I'm not kidding. Thank you so much. I know you put in a lot of work into this and practicing. You did phenomenal and great, great information. So thank you. And we wish all of you a very happy Administrative Professionals Week and day tomorrow. Yes. So celebrate you all the rest of this week. Bye, everyone.